morning, everyone. It's a beautiful day in New Hampshire at a beautiful spot, and we're here to talk about some good news. I'm really pleased to be joined by the entire New Hampshire congressional delegation, my colleague Senator Hassan, Congresswoman Kuster, Congressman Pappas, and also by Mayor Joyce Craig. Congratulations on your reelection. By Commissioner Sheehan, who is the, as we all know, the head of the Department of Transportation for the state, and Deputy Commissioner Sanborn, to celebrate the historic investments in bipartisan infrastructure legislation that just passed through the House. Yes, that's good. That's a good applause line. And we're here today for a specific reason, because one of those bridges that is in tough shape that needs work is the Amiskag Bridge, which is right behind us. It's one of about 600 bridges in New Hampshire that are considered in need of assistance. I, for one, am very glad this day has finally come. I started working on that bipartisan infrastructure package back in April with a bipartisan group of 10 of us, 5 Republicans and 5 Democrats. We worked and finally got the bill through the Senate in August, and the House has had it since then, and I'm sure that the Congress members will talk a little bit about that. But I know that it wasn't easy to get the bill done either in the House or Senate, but I think the important thing is, because of what we were hearing from mayors like Mayor Craig, from commissioners like those here about the needs of this country, we kept at it. And because we were able to keep at it, we really have now passed a once in a generation, really once in my lifetime, investment in infrastructure. And so what does it mean for New Hampshire? It will help rebuild our roads and bridges. I misspoke earlier. There are actually 215 bridges in New Hampshire, like the Amiskag, that are in poor condition. There are 698 miles of roadway that are in need of repair. And based on the funding formula in the infrastructure bill alone, the Granite State should receive about $1.1 billion for federal highway aid, apportioned programs, $225 million for bridge replacement and repairs over the next 5 years. That's why Commissioner Sheehan is smiling. And that really doesn't include grant opportunities. So when people ask me, you know, so how much money is New Hampshire going to get from this proposal? We don't know quite. There's a give and take here, because there's the ability of municipalities to apply separately for money from the state. There are programs like the broadband that will go to states based on the plans that they submit. There's a $100 million floor for all of the states in broadband, but it really depends on how active the states are and the organizations, the communities within states as well. We'll be eligible for funding under the $12.5 billion Bridge Investment Program for economically significant bridges. And in addition to roads, rails, ports, and airports, I'm incredibly proud of the water infrastructure and broadband provisions, which I personally helped to negotiate with Senator Romney and Senator Collins. And Senator Hassan also worked on those broadband provisions in a way that has made a huge difference. We also have $10 billion in this legislation that will help with PFAS remediation, not just in New Hampshire, but across the country. And we know how challenging PFAS has been in our communities. And the bill will also repeal a portion of the 2017 tax bill that has led to at least $1.15 million in new federal taxes for water infrastructure projects in southern New Hampshire, something called the Contribution in Aid of Construction, which we have now reinstituted. It also addresses the longstanding health concerns related to lead service lines and lead pipes. New Hampshire should expect to receive more than $400 million over 5 years to improve water infrastructure, so every family can trust the safety of water coming out of their spigot. And we know what the digital divide did during COVID, the challenges that families had with kids trying to go to school remotely, and parents trying to work from home. This will address that in a significant way. New Hampshire will receive a minimum of $100 million to bolster our broadband coverage, and we will also be able to help families who have not been able to afford to access the internet. So I could go on and on, as you can tell, but I will try not to, because we have lots of folks who are going to talk today about the importance of this legislation. And again, I think this is the result of the good efforts of so many people, both in the Senate and the House, and people across this country, advocating that we need to make these investments in the future of America. And I'm so pleased we were able to get it done. Thank you. Now, I'm delighted to introduce my colleague, Senator Hassan, who can also share her perspective on this legislation. Thank you, Senator Hassan.
Well, thank you, Senator Shaheen. It's great to be here with the full delegation, as well as Mayor Craig and Commissioner Sheehan and Assistant Commissioner Sanborn. Thank you all for the work you do. I know that we all look forward to working with you as this plan, this infrastructure bill, becomes reality. This is a true game changer for New Hampshire. This bipartisan infrastructure package is an investment that's going to pave the way to create new jobs, help our economy thrive, and outcompete China. As I worked with Republicans and Democrats to help negotiate this legislation, I focused on key priorities that people, including small business owners in New Hampshire, have been raising for years. And I'll discuss just a few of those now. To start, as Senator Shaheen noted, there are hundreds of bridges and miles of roads in our state that are in desperate need of repair. We expect New Hampshire to receive $1 billion for federal aid highway programs and hundreds of millions for bridge replacement and repairs over the next 5 years. The infrastructure package includes pieces that I've worked on that could be used to help develop the Capital Corridor, which would connect Nashua, Manchester, and Concord to Boston by rail. This could help businesses recruit more workers, help people get to work faster, and bring more visitors to New Hampshire to support our tourist economy. It also includes investments in modern infrastructure, including high-speed internet. High-speed internet is the definition of modern infrastructure, helping our small businesses grow and connecting people to work. That's why I push for significant funding in the package to help build out high-speed internet access, including at least $100 million for New Hampshire. We also know that climate change is a direct threat to our infrastructure. We have to be prepared to help our communities adapt and respond. This bill includes major investments in our electric grid to help improve its dependability and ensure that we can incorporate clean energy. And I work to secure funding to strengthen coastal resiliency efforts on the seacoast. This funding will help mitigate the impact of flooding and other natural disasters that our coastal communities face. The package also delivers on our responsibility to ensure that all Granite Staters and all Americans have clean drinking water. It invests in our water infrastructure, as you heard Senator Shaheen lay out, and includes an amendment that I led to help get our towns new technology so that they can remove PFAS chemicals from our drinking water. I am really glad that we were able to work with both members of both parties to help shape this bill, and I'm really grateful to the people of New Hampshire, the businesses, the mayors, the citizens all around the state who came forward to talk to us about what's important to them, what's important to the future of our state, how we can all grow and thrive if we make these kinds of common sense, long overdue investments together. This package is a direct investment in the people of New Hampshire and our economy, and it is a reminder of what's possible when Republicans and Democrats work together to get results for the American people. So thank you now, and I'll turn it over to my friend and colleague, Congresswoman Kuster.
Great. Thank you so much, Senator Hassan. Thank you, Senator Shaheen, both of you, for your leadership in the Senate on this bipartisan game-changer legislation. Thank you, Mayor Craig, for your leadership here in Manchester, and Commissioner Sheehan and Commissioner Sanborn, thank you for being with us. So the American Society of Civil Engineers recently gave New Hampshire a C- on our infrastructure report card. And as someone who spends countless hours driving my district all the way to Canada, I've seen firsthand how much our roads and bridges need help. It doesn't help that we have such harsh winters as well. So I was incredibly proud to co-sponsor the bill and to work on it in the House. The Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, and I want to really focus in on that. These are good jobs, high-paying jobs, high-quality jobs with benefits available right here, right now in New Hampshire, and more funding for this infrastructure to come. Now, my colleague Chris Pappas and I did the tag team when the bill came over from the Senate, and it's bipartisan. I really want to emphasize that. It was bipartisan in the House as well. I serve on the House Energy and Commerce Committee, in the Energy Subcommittee, and we spent hours, countless hours, four full days, two of them until 1:30 in the morning, marking up our portion of the bill. I also serve on the Agriculture Committee, and we pitched in as well. You've heard about the roads and bridges and highways. Over $1 billion coming to New Hampshire. We have to keep our M's and B's and T's straight. But that's $1 billion coming to New Hampshire. Another $225 million for fixing bridges. This will get people to work and home to their families. One thing we've learned from COVID-19, when you pull the curtain back, there were structural inequalities and issues that did not work for modern families. They want to be home. They want to take their kids to after-school programs and go to sports programs and coach and be together as a family. Let's not spend hours of every day stuck in traffic. Let's get to work, get the goods to market, and get home to our families. $66 billion for rail investments. We've all been working on this project of bringing the rail from Boston to Nashua to Manchester. Again, getting people to work, getting the goods to market safely, efficiently, and quickly. These funds, along with provisions in the Invest in American Railroads Act, will make it so much easier for us to push through on this capital project, capital corridor project. And I couldn't be more excited about that. It's a game changer, helping us attract workers and entire industries to our state. We had a visit yesterday to a company that has just opened another site in Nashua. They have millions of dollars coming in federal contracts in the defense space, but they need more workers. And bringing those jobs and those workers to New Hampshire is going to make a big difference. And you've heard about the broadband. Again, COVID-19 pulling back the curtain. Heartbreaking conversations with families trying to educate their children at home, people trying to work from home, and people getting their health care from home and not having access to high quality, high speed, affordable internet. Today, that changes. This digital economy will come to every single household in the state. I want to give a shout out to an additional $150 million to the Northern Border Regional Commission. You've heard all of us talk for years about how the North Country feels left out. No longer. People are moving there because they want to live there and work there. If we give them high-speed broadband access through this Northern Borders Regional Commission funding, if we give them infrastructure so they can get down to the city when they need to, it'll be a game changer and people can enjoy the wonderful quality of life in the North Country. So I want to end with one specific project that we've been working on. And that sounds old school, and it's going to be the future of our clean energy. And that's hydro dams. Here in New Hampshire, hundreds of dams that need help with retrofitting, rehabilitation, and removal. Thank you, Chris. We've worked with environmental groups, groups that care about the quality of the water and the recreational opportunities and clean energy. And what we know is we can create good, clean energy to help save our planet by putting turbines into these hydro dams. And so there's funding in this bill, over $2 billion, and hopefully funding in the next bill to come by way of a hydro tax credit. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Chris Pappas, and hopefully we'll be right back here in just a few weeks to talk about the next bill, the Build Back Better, that will have infrastructure on the family side, family caregiving, child care, access to early education, senior care. So stay tuned. We've got a lot more coming. Chris?
Thank you, Annie. Well, thank you so much. It's great to be with you all. As you see, we could talk about infrastructure all day here. And we'll continue a little bit in that vein because this is just such an important bill, a watershed moment for the country. I'm a member of the House Transportation Infrastructure Committee. We've been working for the better part of the last two terms on creating a transformational infrastructure program, reauthorizing surface transportation. We finally, thanks to the help of a bipartisan majority in the Senate and the negotiating of Senator Shaheen and Senator Hassan, we were able to get this accomplished for the American people, and it's a great day. So we can dispense with all the jokes about Infrastructure Week because this is real. Yeah. We're about to see shovels go in the ground and work getting done here in New Hampshire. I'm thankful for the leadership of Commissioner Sheehan. Great to be with you. Thanks for the role you played on really a national stage at helping to advocate for this bill. And it's great to see Mark Sanborn. Welcome back to New Hampshire. It's good to have you here too. And to Joyce Craig, it's always great to be in Manchester. So look, the investments in this bill aren't Democratic or Republican investments. These are really common sense solutions that are of local significance and national significance as well. This bill is going to expand investment in a number of critical areas that the delegation has helped outline. Biggest investment in public transit ever. It makes the largest federal investment in rail in decades. And the programmatic support in this bill is going to help to bring about passenger rail expansion here in New Hampshire, and I couldn't be more excited about that. New Hampshire is also going to see a 47% bump in the amount of formula funding that's coming for our highways. That's really significant at keeping pace with the needs and hopefully helping to advance some projects on that 10-year plan that the commissioner worked so hard on. And as Senator Shaheen and Senator Hassan mentioned, the support for broadband is just essential. Making sure all of our households, all of our businesses are connected to the internet so that they can fully participate in the economy. We thank you for your work on that. That is really great for New Hampshire. Also the biggest investment in water and wastewater infrastructure in our nation's history. And so across the state, we're hearing a lot about projects that are ready to go and ideas that are coming up from the community level. I know here in Manchester, we've put a lot of focus on the issue of sewage overflow into this river right here. Every year, about 500 million gallons of sewage is dumped into the Merrimack River from communities along this watershed in New Hampshire and Massachusetts. It's an environmental concern. It's a public health concern. We have about 500,000 people that get their drinking water from the Merrimack River. And so it's important that we continue to help cities like Manchester make the upgrades that are necessary to modernize it and to protect public health and the environment. Manchester's underway in doing that work, but we need the federal support that's coming through this bill to help realize that. And I'm proud that there's $1.4 billion to address this issue of combined sewage overflow. That's a big deal for Manchester. I was in Newington yesterday. We've got a water main that goes under Little Bay. Provides 60% of the drinking water for Portsmouth and other communities on the seacoast. It's in danger of failing, and the state revolving fund money that's going to come to New Hampshire through this bill, including some significant principal forgiveness that comes with those loans, is going to be really helpful at making sure that things like the Little Bay water line can get completed. Also was in Exeter recently. They've got a sewage main that goes under the Squamscott River. Similar situation. It could fail any month now. And so there are emergency upgrades that need to be made. The funding in this bill is going to help address that wastewater project and others all across our state. So the cost of doing nothing here far exceeds the cost of this bill. This is really a smart investment and a down payment on our future. And I think as we gather here in Manchester, we can appreciate the infrastructure that is all around us and what built this city. You know, back in the 19th century, it was big brick mill buildings and canals and steam engines that powered Manchester and New Hampshire at that point in time. We know that the infrastructure we need for the 21st century looks a lot different. And that's why this bill is so transformational. It's not just about rehabilitating what we have, it's about building for the future. And I'm really proud to be here as someone who helped shepherd this through the House and know it will be signed into law very soon. I think this infrastructure bill moves us toward that bright future, creates the backbone of economic success for our country, is going to create a lot of good paying jobs along the way. And I'm glad that the House of Representatives finally got to yes on this bill. After many weeks of folks trying to figure out the bright process, we got it done. So with that, I want to turn it over to the Mayor of Manchester, Joyce Craig, for some comments. Joyce.
Thank you, Congressman Pappas. It's so great to be here with all of you and to have the entire congressional delegation here in our fine city, as well as the commissioners. As you've heard, this is a historic moment for Manchester, for New Hampshire, and for our entire country. From strengthening broadband access to critical investments in our roads, bridges, and clean drinking water, the Bipartisan Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act will improve the quality of lives for Granite Staters by making the much-needed improvements in our local communities. So investing in and improving infrastructure is one of my top priorities, as well as the residents of the city of Manchester. And over the past 4 years, we've updated over 183 miles of roads and sidewalks throughout the city, made historic investments in our parks and our trails. And as Congressman Pappas stated, we started implementing a $230 million 20-year plan to reduce combined sewer overflow into the Merrimack River. And we're building the largest municipal solar array in the state. And as Congressman Pappas and the other federal delegation has said, this bill now will help us move these projects and others forward in the city of Manchester. And I want to recognize also there are members from the Department of Public Works here, as well as Hoyle Tanner, who have worked collectively on these projects. And I'm happy to say you're about to be much busier. I'd also be remiss if I didn't mention how this bipartisan infrastructure deal will create thousands of new good-paying jobs and will invest millions of dollars in expanding commuter rail, both of which will have a positive impact on the day-to-day lives of residents, as well as setting us up for future success. So it's such an exciting time, and I want to thank our congressional delegation for reaching across the aisle and delivering this bipartisan legislation. Thank you very, very much. I'd now like to introduce Commissioner Victoria Sheehan.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's great to be here today. And I want to thank our federal delegation for providing this opportunity to talk about what the passage of the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act will mean for New Hampshire's transportation infrastructure specifically. Funding uncertainty can be extremely disruptive and makes it very difficult for state DOTs to plan and deliver projects. So the passage of a five-year bill provides stability and allows us to develop our transportation plans with certainty as to what federal funding will be available. This is critical because as we work with communities, elected officials, and other transportation stakeholders, we need to be able to identify what funding is available and when projects and programs can move forward. So what does the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, or IIJA, provide for New Hampshire? Overall, we're going to see a 24% increase in our core federal highway programs. Further, over the five-year period, we'll receive an additional $225 million for bridge infrastructure. This is really important because in 2020, there were 118 state-owned redless bridges in New Hampshire, and 223 municipally owned redless bridges, like the one behind us. And so this additional investment will help us to not only rehab and replace those structures, but prevent other bridges from becoming structurally deficient. The bill also creates a new electric vehicle charging infrastructure program, and it's expected that New Hampshire will receive a total of $17 million over the five-year period, with additional opportunities to apply for grant opportunities. For New Hampshire airports, we expect to see around $45.5 million, and for public transportation, we are anticipating approximately $131 million, which represents a 30% increase in funding levels from prior bills. So here in New Hampshire, we have a very transparent process, and we develop a 10-year plan for transportation that we update every 2 years. The department is currently working with the Executive Council, who has been meeting as GASET, the Governor's Advisory Commission on Intermodal Transportation, to develop the draft 10-year plan for the years 2023 through 2032. So with the passage of this bill, everyone's asking, which projects will we be advancing? The department has just conducted 22 public hearings, 21 in-person or hybrid, and one fully virtual hearing to hear from the citizens of the state as to what their transportation priorities are. We've also conducted a survey to further help with the development of the 10-year plan. The public comment period for the 10-year plan just ended yesterday, so the timing is perfect. We will now be meeting with the Executive Council to update the plan to reflect the available federal dollars. Because of the level of bipartisan support for the plan, we had anticipated some increases in federal funding, but we now can refine the plan to both reflect the priorities of our citizens and also to ensure that we're making the most of this opportunity to invest in our systems. So what will happen next? Well, we'll refine the 10-year plan working with the Executive Council. Then we'll send it to the governor for his consideration. And finally, the plan will be delivered to the legislature and advanced this session before being signed into law in June of 2022. So we're very excited about this opportunity. And there's several other provisions in the bill that we're looking at closely. In addition to the increase in our formula funding, there will be numerous discretionary grant opportunities as well. And so we will continue to pursue those chances to secure additional dollars beyond those that are programmed. And we also want to acknowledge the work of Senator Shaheen. Within this legislation, there is established what's called a toll credit marketplace pilot. So in New Hampshire, we invest very heavily in our turnpike system. And as we do so, we earn credits. This particular program would allow us to turn those credits into cash. And so we are going to be working with USDOT to learn more about that opportunity. And then lastly, I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge the significant investment in the other modes of infrastructure. So not only will the Department of Transportation be advancing the projects that will be funded with the dollars we receive directly, we will be working with the governor's office and with all of the other state agencies to understand what role we play as we strategize on how to best use the investment in broadband as well as water and wastewater infrastructure. So there's a lot of work ahead of us, but the men and women of the New Hampshire DOT stand ready to work with our private sector partners, the consultants and contractors who help us deliver projects each and every day, as well as the other state agencies that we collaborate with. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Assistant Commissioner Mark Sanborn from the Department of Environmental Services, one of the agencies we work with the most closely.
Thanks, Victoria. Good morning. It's a real pleasure to be here representing the hardworking, mission-driven staff of the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. Over the last 6 years, under the leadership of Governor Chris Sununu, New Hampshire has made investment in infrastructure a top priority. Whether it's addressing the transportation infrastructure needs, such as completion of the I-93 widening project in southern New Hampshire, or the work we are doing at New Hampshire DES to address the dams in our state that need to be repaired or removed, Governor Sununu has been on the out front on all of these infrastructure issues. Governor Sununu has also tackled the PFAS issue head on and has been addressing clean drinking water issues in general. Three areas where the governor has been a leader is infrastructure, energy infrastructure, broadband, and electric vehicles and charging station. New Hampshire DES and the newly established New Hampshire Department of Energy have recently released two RFPs, one funding an assessment of the potential economic, environmental, and energy impacts of New Hampshire of the deployment of offshore wind in the Gulf of Maine, and the other will fund electric vehicle charging stations at public locations throughout the state. This bipartisan bill will provide additional funding in all of these areas so we can build on the work already being done to improve infrastructure projects of all type and invest in clean drinking water for all Granite Staters through the funding of the Drinking Water and Clean Water State Revolving Funds. As the governor has said on numerous occasions, we are all entitled to clean drinking water. Thank you to our entire New Hampshire congressional delegation for the hard work and support of the programs in this legislation. Some additional areas of investment in this bill are the coastal zone management, habitat restoration, and restoring fish passages. Not only are all of these programs important in and of themselves, but they are also important in our efforts to explore offshore wind, as these are all mitigation issues for the deployment of any wind farm. Finally, a big thank you to Senator Sheen and her staff, who worked tirelessly with DES Commissioner Bob Smith to include a provision in the bill to restore the exemptions for the contribution in aid of construction tax, also known as CIAC, that applies to privately owned but publicly regulated utilities. This is going to make a huge difference for a number of utilities in the state and their ability to improve addressing contamination issues. As we look to utilize the funding in this bill, it is important to make sure we are investing in the right projects that will improve quality of life, create economic development, protect our natural resources and the environment, and invest in public health and safety. I can assure you that under the leadership of Governor Sununu, that is exactly what we're going to do at New Hampshire DES and the other agencies will do once we receive this funding. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you all very much for your comments. If anyone has any questions after all those brilliant remarks,
Senator,
we would be happy to answer them, and please let us know who you want it directed to.
Senator, a question for the delegation as a whole. All these investments are great, but if people can't afford to get from point A to point B because of rising gas prices, what can be done?
Well, as you know, it's one of the things that we're working on. Senator Hassan and I sent a letter to the administration asking that they think about releasing funds from the oil reserve as we're looking at where we are. There are a number of efforts to address the supply chain issues. I was at UPS last week meeting with grocers and Retail Federation to talk about some of their challenges. It's a long-term problem, but the more we can do through this bill to invest in alternative sources of energy, in electric cars so we're not totally reliant on gasoline-driven cars, in alternative, you know, whether it's offshore wind or energy efficiency, the better we're going to be prepared in the future. Any of you like to?
Somebody talk about next steps for the community project.
One of you like to want to address that, Maggie?
Commissioner, did you hear that?
Did you hear that?
Next steps for the commuter rail project?
So the Department of Transportation is currently advancing the Capital Corridor Rail project, and we're in what's called the project development phase. And so we're actually going to be conducting a public meeting to update citizens on the status of the project. The project development phase includes the final design, the permitting, as well as the development of a financial plan, which will articulate options on how we fund both the construction as well as the operating expenses associated with the rail line. So that project is currently working through that process. We've, over the last several weeks, been meeting with the City of Nashua and the City of Manchester to refine the location of stations as well as a layover facility. But all of that information will be provided at the public meeting that's scheduled, I believe it's next week.
And when may the project development phase wrap?
It really depends on how long it takes to develop the financial plan, but we're expecting at least another 12 months before we'd be ready to make a determination on next steps.
Any other questions? Okay. Well, thank you all very much for coming, and thank you to everybody who's here for all of your hard work to get us to this point.